Don't hope that everybody is familiar with the subject. Wait. Yes. So I don't hope that everybody is familiar with the subject. So what I will do first is make a small introduction about directed polymer in a random environment. Then I will talk about the issue of scaling limits, so finding a continuum model, which is in some sense a limit of the discrete model when some parameter tend to zero or infinity, and I will be more precise about that when I come to this. And then I will present our result, which concerns a directed polymer in a random environment, which is heavy-tailed, so where the random variables composing the environment have no second moment. Okay, so I think everything will make sense when I now introduce the model. So, what is directed polymer in a random environment? Well, it's a model of statistical mechanics, which is supposed to account for the following situation. So, we have a polymer chain, which is a big linear molecule. And that is.
Sorry, Hubert, we see the participants window in your screen. I don't know if you can fix that part.
Okay.
Can you?
I won't see the participants anymore, I think.
There are plenty of people.
So we have a polymer chain, which is in a solution in which you have impurities. Some impurities will attract the polymer, some impurities will repel the polymer. And what you want to know is if these inhomogeneities in the solution will affect the conformal config, well, the spatial conformation of the polymer on a large scale. So, okay, this physical situation is kind of a pretext, in fact, to have a model for which you can say something about the influence of inhomogeneities or the influence of disorder. So we'll try to simplify it a lot. And the big simplification we take is to say that our polymers, they are modeled by the graph of a nearest neighbor path in ZD. So by saying that the polymer is modeled by the graph of something, what you are saying is that the polymer stretches in one privileged direction. This is not very physical, but this will help a lot for the analysis of the problem. Okay, so this is what our polymers are. So you fix a length n, which is an integer, and a polymer is a graph of a nearest neighbor path starting from zero on ZD and of a length n. And now for the impurities, what we do is that on each site of the lattice on which this graph lives, we put a random variables, and we choose these random variables to be IID. And okay, I will choose them to have mean zero, and they will be larger than minus one. And now we define for each configuration a weight, which is simply the product among all visited sites of one plus beta eta. And okay, I've chosen eta and beta so that these things are always positive. Okay, so now what are directed polymer in a random environment? Well, it's simply a random measure on my set of paths such that the probability of each path is proportional to this weight. Okay, so maybe it's more convenient to define this as a probability on the set of infinite paths, but it's kind of the same thing. So we'll define our polymer measure to be the measure which is absolutely continuous with respect to the simple random walk measure on ZD. And the density is going to be proportional to this product I defined before. Okay, and because we want this to be a probability, you need a renormalizing factor, which is just the expectation of this product with respect to the simple random walk. Okay, and this thing I will call the partition function. So for people that have already seen talks about directed polymers, it's really more common to have this path weights expressed in this exponential form. Somehow, I mean, these two things are in practice equivalent, but I've chosen this form because this is really more convenient for the problem we are presenting today. Okay, and I might come back to that later. Okay, so now the objective of people that studied directed polymer was to understand the behavior of typical S under this measure when N becomes large. So you fix eta, you fix beta, and you want to know the typical behavior of a random pass under this measure. And it turned out that to understand this, the only quantity you need to understand is the partition function. So if you know the asymptotic behavior of the partition function, you will have a lot of information about the asymptotic behavior of the measure. So I will introduce two notions now. We say that we are in the weak disorder regime when our partition function has a positive limit. Okay, and I've taken the parameter of my system so that this thing is a random variable that has expectation one. And we see that we have very strong disorder if our partition function goes to zero at an exponential rate. Okay, and in these two regimes, people have been able to say something about the behavior of the trajectories. So when you have weak disorder, what happens is that essentially the behavior of S on large scale is the same as for the simple random walk. So if you rescale the trajectory by square root of N, the distribution converges to that of a Brownian motion. And on the contrary, when you have very strong disorder, you don't have this property, and your trajectories, they tend to localize around a favorite corridor. So you have a region, a corridor in your environment where the etas are larger, and the typical S will pin to this corridor. So in this regime, the results are much less precise than in the diffusive regime. I mean, particularly because you don't know what when in weak disorder you can compare it with disorder zero. In strong disorder, you don't know what thing you have to compare it to. But people have obtained results, in particular for localization of the endpoint of the trajectories, and that's something that is still has still been going on recently. Okay, so for these results to be meaningful, you need to know something about when you have weak disorder and when you have very strong disorder. So this is the content of the next slide. Okay, and so what has been known very early is that if you are in dimension larger than three, and here we take the assumption that our etas have finite second moment, and that's really important. So if you are in dimension larger than three, then you have a weak disorder regime. In particular, what you have is that if beta is sufficiently small, then you have weak disorder. And in the contrary, on dimension one and two, even for very small beta, you have very strong disorder. Okay, so I've drawn a phase diagram. So basically in dimension three, you expect that for beta large enough, you will have very strong disorder. But in my setup, you can't take beta larger than one. So. Furthermore, what you know is that if you look at the exponential rate of decay of the partition function, you know the asymptotic for small beta in dimension one and two. You know that this thing is always negative, and you know it's asymptotic when beta goes to zero. Okay, so this was what I wanted to say for directed polymer. So now what we want to do is put ourselves in dimension one. So in dimension one, we know that for whatever beta we choose, the partition function will go to zero. But what we want to do is send beta to zero at the same time and see if we can obtain a scaling limit for the model. So the idea is that we want to obtain then a continuous model. And intuitively, what the model should be, you have to replace the random walk by the continuous counterpart, which is Brownian motion. And for the environment, and I'm going to motivate that a little bit more, you want it to replace by space-time white noise. So, let's see how this has been done. So first, let's try to figure out how we should scale beta to have a non-trivial limit. And I told you before that what was important was really the partition function. So if we want the model to have a non-trivial limit, maybe we should scale the beta so that the partition function has a non-trivial limit. And okay, we know from the result of Nakashima that typically the partition function behaves like exponential minus beta to the 4 times n when beta is small. So this kind of indicates that the scaling is, well, you should take beta like n to the minus 1 force to have something non-trivial in the limit. Now you should also rescale space and time diffusively, you know, for your trajectories to scale like a Brownian motion. And in order to obtain some limit for the environment, well, what we do is that we are going to consider the environment as a distribution. So on each point on the lattice, we are going to put a Dirac mass with some amplitude, which is given by the eta corresponding to that point. And if you do that, and if you do the proper rescaling, so in space-time, you will do the rescaling that corresponds to your Brownian motion, and then you will have to rescale by some power of n. Then you obtain in the limit a white noise, a space-time white noise. So now, why is it the right thing to consider your environment as a distribution? Well, if you look at what you do on your environment, basically what you are doing is that you are summing beta, eta along the path. So you are integrating a distribution along the graph of your trajectory. So in my setup, you're not exactly doing that, but because beta is small, okay, I will assume that log 1 plus beta eta is almost the same as beta eta. Okay, it will correspond with the first term in the expansion. Okay, so this allows to describe the putative scaling limit of this model. So you need two things to define your continuous model. You need a reference measure and you need a density. So for the reference measure, you will take Wiener measure instead of the simple random walk measure. And for the density, well, instead of summing, integrating your environment along the graph of the path, what you are going to do is integrate your environment along the graph of your Brownian motion. Okay, so now, maybe I have to say something more about that. If you, well, the graph of a Brownian motion, it's something that has volume, well, area zero or volume zero. So if you integrate white noise against it, you will get zero. So it doesn't seem like very interesting. But actually, this is not what you should do. You should integrate your white noise against something which is much more singular, which is the integral between zero and one of the Dirac mass at TBT. Well, then if you integrate white noise against that formally, it's not that you get something much better, but what you get is a Gaussian that has infinite variance and not zero variance. So there is some problem to define this, but it won't be a trivial object. Okay, and for people that know about Gaussian multiplicative chaos, this is exactly the same kind of thing you're trying to define. The exponential of a field which has infinite variance, but for which you can define the covariance. Okay, so
Humber, can I ask you a quick question?
Yes.
Can you comment on the scaling exponent of 3/4 that you use to rescale the environment? So why is it 3/4?
Okay, why is it 3/4? Well, if you look at the try to integrate it against some fixed set, the number of variables you will have here is n to the is n to the 3/2, okay, because you have n to the 3/2 because we are in dimension 1. So this is some variable of variance n to the 3/2. So by the central limit theorem, to obtain something Gaussian, you have to renormalize by n minus 3/4.
I see. Thanks.
Okay. So yeah, there is nothing mysterious there. My explanation maybe was confusing, but okay. So Now let me tell you how you should interpret this exponential. So I will start with a very simple formula. So let's try to rewrite the exponential of the integral of a function on the time interval 0, 1. So if you take the series expansion of the exponential, what you get is this formula. And you can interpret this integral to the power k as some integral on some on k variables. And well, this integral is an integral, well, on the hypercube on which you're integrating, you have factorial k simplex, and they all give the same contribution. So you can simplify this factor 1 over factorial k by just keeping one of those simplexes, and you get this formula. Okay, so this identity holds if you're considering the integral of some nice function. If you're considering the integral of something less regular, so say the increments of a Brownian motion, then what you get here and what you get there will be something different. But what we will do is we are going to consider this as the true definition of the exponential. Okay, so this is where this is what the dots in the previous slide meant, is that this is going to be our definition for the exponential. Okay, so now what we are interested to define the limiting model, we just want to define the limiting partition function. So we have this exponential which is not well defined, but maybe if you integrate it with respect to the Wiener measure, you will get something nice. So what we can do is take the exponential, make the decomposition we had on the previous slide. And then when you do that, basically, and you average with respect to the Wiener measure, in the end, you can make sense of everything. So these two things have only make sense on the formal level. But somehow, when you take the average, the Dirac mass here will disappear. And what you will obtain in the end will be integral over time and space of your white noise. And what you will have in front will just be some kernel, which just corresponds to the probability that your Brownian motion visits xi at time ti for all I between 1 and k.
So I have a question as well. So the reason you use this formula for the exponential is that this part on the diagonal would be like, it's like to remove some diagonal part in the integral. Is that correct? Or?
Yes. So actually for the Brownian motion, it really corresponds to the diagonal part would give you a contribution because of Ito calculus.
Right.
But yeah, that really corresponds to, yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. So what Albert Canin and Questel have done is really to take this as the definition for the partition function of the continuous model. And the result they obtained was the following. If you take the scaling I've talked about before, and if you take diffusive scaling for your random walk, then the distribution of this three-scale random walk under the polymer measure converges in distribution towards a random limit, which is whose density with respect to the Wiener measure is formally given by this exponential of the white noise integrated along the graph of a Brownian motion. So these things does not make sense for a given trajectory. So even if I've written a density, this measure is absolutely singular with respect to the Wiener measure. Okay. So I won't talk about this measure very much. I will mostly talk about the partition function. So an important, the important step to prove this result is to prove that your partition function converges. Once you can do that, you've done the most difficult thing to prove convergence of the model. So what we have in particular here is that the partition function converges, and we have a square root of two factor that I might talk about later on, but this is not really important for the understanding right now. Okay, so Now I'm going to talk about what we did, but just before that, let me make a small detour about what happens in other dimensions. So I've talked only about.
I have a question for the result that you just showed. Were there moment conditions, or is it like just second moment?
Yes, I'm sorry. Yes, you need to have finite second moment. And for scaling reasons here, I've taken the moment to be one.
Okay, thank you. Okay.
And it really depends on what kind of convergence you want to have. You have a better quality of convergence if you assume fixed moment, but to have this result, you only need second moment. Okay, so what happened in a higher dimension? So if you are in dimension larger than three, actually, your partition function will converge to one as soon as you send beta to zero, even if you send it to zero very slowly. So this thing of finding a limit does not really make sense. People have looked at other problem, which is look at the fluctuation of this quantity around one when beta tends to zero, but this is really a different game. When d equals two, well, for fixed beta, Zn beta tends to zero. So there must be some beta n such that you can obtain something non-trivial. So actually, the right scale to look at is the following. And yes, some people, including people in the audience, have looked at this regime and prove that indeed you have some form of tightness. So when you have beta scaling like this, you converge subsequently towards some random measure, which is not the Wiener measure. But however, what is known is that the scaling limit has a different nature because you can't define the exponential, the ordered exponential I talked about a few slides ago in dimension two. So people also have tried to make sense to give an to do some rescaling in order to make sense of this. But okay, if you have to do some rescaling to make sense of this, this means that this is not exactly the same object in nature that you will have at the end. Okay, so dimension larger than three and dimension two are really a different game compared to dimension one. Okay, so now I'm going to talk about our work with Quentin. So in all I've said before, really the assumption that we had finite second moment was really crucial. And the crucial point where we used it was when we used the central limit theorem to say that the environment converges to the white noise. So what we wanted to understand is what happened when you don't have this assumption. So what we assumed is that, we still had mean zero environment, but that we assumed that the distribution had a power tail with exponent which is between one and two, so that we wouldn't have second moment. And okay, if you do that, then the environment converges to a random distribution, which is not white noise, but it is rather somehow the Levy process equivalent of alpha stable equivalent of white noise. And what we tried to do was to define some alpha stable equivalent of the continuum polymer and prove that the discrete model converges to it if you consider the right scaling. So if you have such a project, the first thing you want to know is what condition you have to impose in the dimension, because we've seen that in the Brownian case, in the second moment case, we could only consider dimension one. So in order to answer this question B, somehow the big part of the work was done by Roberto Viveros, who recently defended his PhD at IMPA. So he looked at the model without sending beta to zero for fixed beta. And he looked at which condition on the dimension you have very strong disorder at for every beta. So what he showed is that if the dimension is smaller than 2 over alpha minus 1, then your partition function converges exponentially to 0 for every beta. So even if the disorder has small amplitude, the partition function will converge to 0. And that, on the contrary, when the dimension is larger than this threshold, then you have a weak disorder phase. So the partition function converges to something non-trivial when beta is small. And more than that, he also identified the critical exponent when you have strong disorder, when you in dimension below the threshold. So showing that your rate of decay of the partition function behaves like a power of beta when beta is small, and the exponent is given by this. Okay, so in view of what we had in the second moment case, we'd better look at dimensions smaller than 2 to the alpha minus 1. Okay, so this 2 over alpha minus 1, it has the equivalent role as dimension 2 had before. And as for the scaling, if the partition function behaves like exponential to the minus beta to the new times n, then we should take beta proportional to n to the minus 1 over nu in order to see something non-trivial in the limit. Okay, so now we'll try to tell you what the continuous limit is. And for this, okay, what I will first do is introduce the alpha stable noise, then define the partition function of the continuum model with alpha stable noise, and finally present our result of convergence of the discrete model to the continuum model. Okay, so we have two results. We are able to define the continuum model and to show that the discrete model converges to it. Okay, so what's our definition for alpha stable space-time noise? So I guess it's the classical one. So what we start with is a Poisson point process. We have three coordinates in our Poisson process. The first two are the space-time coordinates we have in our r times rd, and the third one will kind of stands for the amplitude of the atoms we have in our process. So the intensity we will take for the Poisson process will be Lebesgue for the two first coordinates, and something like that has the same decay as our etas for the intensity. And we want to define the random distribution, which is obtained basically by summing Dirac masses for all the points in the Poisson process. So for each point in the Poisson process, we want to put a Dirac mass whose space-time coordinates are given by the two force coordinates in my Poisson process, and whose intensity, whose amplitude is given by the third coordinate. And the problem is that if you do that, of course, you will obtain the measure which gives infinite weight to any open subset. So what we do instead of that is, we impose a threshold, and we only sum over points which have an amplitude larger than A. And in order to recenter things out, we delete some constant times the Lebesgue measure so that this random distribution has average zero. Okay, and then if you want to have to obtain some non-trivial limit, you send A to zero, and this thing converges in some Sobolev space to some random to some limit, which is the alpha space-time noise. Okay, does this make sense? So this is what played the role of our space-time white noise in the for the other continuum model. So by analogy, if you want to define a continuum model that corresponds to this noise, what we should do is use the same formula. So integrate our Brownian kernel against integrated integral, which involves the Brownian kernel and the alpha stable noise.
Sorry, Hubert, I have a question.
Yes.
Just for clarity, the random measure you obtain, it is a signed measure because you are compensating.
It is not even a measure. It's a distribution.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
When you put the threshold, it's a signed measure. And in the limit, it does not converge as a measure, but the total variation goes to infinity, but it still converges as a distribution. Yes. Thank you, Francesco. Okay. And because it's a distribution with infinite total variation, it's not obvious how to define this integral, and we don't have the tools of stochastic calculus to show that it's well defined. So we took another route to show that this made sense. So what we did with Quentin was to consider this partition function, but first for the noise with the threshold at A. Okay, so you only look at the points of your Poisson point process that have amplitude larger than A. Now you can perfectly make sense of this because you are integrated against measures that have locally finite variations. And it's not too difficult to show that the series converge. So this thing makes sense. And now if you look at this as a process indexed by A, then this is a martingale. So it's a time reverse martingale, because when you decrease A, somehow you add information to the process. And it does not appear in this form, but this thing is non-negative. And therefore, for free, you know that it converges when A tends to zero. Okay, so in order to have something interesting, you want the limit is not equal to zero. And what we proved is that you obtain a positive limit almost surely if and only if your dimension is smaller than the threshold 2 over alpha minus 1. And that in the other cases, your thing converges to zero almost surely. Okay, and I've just written this part of the theorem, but once you've done that, you can define a measure on the set of, on the set of continuum trajectory, which corresponds to this partition function. Okay, so once you have this, you can really define the continuum model corresponding to this partition function.
I have a question.
Yes.
For your limiting random distribution, is there a covariance function of that?
Is there
a covariance function? So what should be the covariance function of that limiting environment?
The converse function?
The covariance function.
The covariance function. The continuum model for the polymer, it's a measure on the state of continuous path.
No, I'm talking about the environment.
The limit is non-Gaussian, and point-wise, it doesn't have a second moment, so you can't define a covariance.
But you can take two different points, right?
If you integrate it against any set, what you obtained is an alpha stable variable, so that you don't have second moment. So you don't.
Oh, I see. Okay, I see. Thanks.
I also have questions in the chat. So, in the case when alpha is below one, people are wondering what's going on because you cannot recenter.
Yeah, so but in the case when alpha is below one, actually, you can play this game. But in the first place, you don't have the discrete model because you can't have alpha smaller than one and the eta to be centered. Okay, I mean, you could define the discrete model, but you wouldn't have this weak disorder, strong disorder dichotomy because of that, because you don't have the expectation of Z, which is equal to one. You can have this, but then there is no difficulty here in defining the partition function because, okay, where was I? Your noise simply converges without recentering here.
Okay.
Okay, and the distribution you obtained, it has finite total variation. So you have no problem. You can define this directly without taking the limit when a goes to zero.
I see. Okay, thank you.
And you can do that, I guess, in any dimension. Yes. Which makes sense. D is smaller than, well, okay, infinity. Okay, so then what was our second result? Well, it's not very surprising. When D is smaller than the threshold and when you rescale beta with the scaling I told you before, this exponent here is something negative, then the distribution of your rescale path converge to that, to the continuum model in the sense of convergence of in distribution. So in particular here, the important statement to prove this is to show that the partition function converges in distribution to the continuum partition function. While proving this, we proved a more detailed statement, which is joint convergence of the environment and the partition function. So, when I introduced the first continuum model, I said, okay, the environment converges to the noise. You have to be a bit more careful about that. Actually, you don't care about every site in the environment. You only care about the sites that the random walk can visit. Okay, so I will only consider sites in this sublattice where X and N have the same parity. And if you do that, if you look at the distribution corresponding to this site and rescale in the appropriate fashion, the distribution you have converged to some noise. Okay, and because you're considering only half of the sites, you have to put some power of alpha in order to have the constant matchings. And this is where this power of two comes from. Not power of alpha, power of two. And what we prove is not only convergence of the partition function, but what we have is that the couple of the noise and of the partition function converge to the continuous noise and continuous partition function. Okay, so we have joint convergence. Strictly speaking, this is not completely new because all the tools to prove that were also available. This is also true for the Brownian polymer, and the tools to prove that were also available, but it had not been noticed before. So I wanted to underline this, that the noise you find in the limit is really the limit of the environment. I'm close to finished. Maybe I will try to give just a bit of idea about the proof. But first, let me say one thing about our setup. So I've taken the weights to be product of 1 plus beta eta instead of exponential beta eta. So normally, it does not make much difference because when people work under this exponential setup, they assume that etas, the eta have all exponential moments. Okay, but when you start to consider etas that have power tails, the two setups become very different, And what happens here is that if you take heavy tail environment, what will happen is that the environment will be completely dominated by the sites where eta has a large value. Okay, because exponential beta eta will give much more importance to this as 1 plus beta eta. Okay. So for this reason, if you look at scaling limit for this thing, in the heavy tail, in an heavy tail setup, what you will get is that the maximal values of this will completely attract the polymer, and if you get some convergence, it will be towards the Dirac on the favorite path that visits all the best sites. Okay, so it's really a totally different game. It has been studied by other people, and you don't get the same results when you consider these things. Okay. Okay, so now maybe I can say one word about what we had to do to prove the convergence of the partition function martingale.
Sorry, Hubert.
Yes.
If you can come back to the previous slide.
Yes.
So your setting of heavy tails, if you translate it to the exponential setup, would correspond to something like stretched exponential for the etas or something.
Yeah. So the big problem you have, if you want to have polynomial tail in my setup, the setup we considered corresponds to exponential tail here.
Okay.
And the problem is that here, if you have exponential tail, the power tail for exponential beta eta depends on beta.
Okay.
So if you want to send beta to zero while keeping the same exponent, it's really something you can't do. So you have to look at something else.
So okay. If you're willing to play more, you can change the law a little bit as you rescale beta.
Yes, I mean, somehow if you change the law as you rescale beta, this is exactly what we did.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, so, yes, so if you want to show that a martingale converges to some non-trivial limit, you want to show that it's uniformly integrable, and usually what you do to prove that is to prove that it's bounded in LP. The problem here, and the problem you may encounter very often, is that here you can only compute integer moments with explicit computation, and your second moment is infinite because the noise you have doesn't have second moment. Okay, so you can't do LP computation for p between 1 and 2. So what we want to do is say restrict oneself to one event and show that the partition function restricted to that event almost skips full math. Okay, the partition function normally it has expectation 1. We want to say that again that this event it has almost expectation 1, but that once you have this restriction, you are bounded in L2. So when d equals 1, actually this ID works. The reason why you have infinite second moment is just because you can have some points in the environment that takes very high values. But if you discard these points which appear with small probability, then you have finite second moment. And you have a 5-line proof of the convergence of your martingale. But when d is larger than 2, somehow this doesn't work. You have some other reasons for the divergence of your second moment. And you have to use a refinement of this ID. Namely, you have to pick somehow a restriction that kind of depends on, your partition function is morally some expectation with respect to the Wiener measure. For each path, you are going to consider a different restriction. And if you implement this idea, you will get something that works in dimension D. Okay, so I think my time is up, so I will finish here, and thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Hubert. So we have thanks for stopping right on time. So we have time for several questions. In the chat, feel free to ask questions, and also our three facilitators can ask questions if they want.
Milton has a question. I can't see the chat, but I can see.
Okay, let me try to unmute Milton. Oh yes, I hadn't seen the. Yeah, thanks for Milton. Can you speak?
Yes. Thanks, Web, for the very nice talk. I hope you're enjoying Marseille, and maybe you're locked down and you're not enjoying anything. But first question. I have two questions. Okay. So the first question is that. Does your process satisfy some sort of SPD? I mean, like in the finite second moment case, the right object is the solution of the stochastic Hill equation. There is some equation here going on, or
I have to guarantee that this is not staged, but I have some extra slide with for the. So, in dimension, for the Brownian polymer, well, it's only because it's a very natural question. So for the Brownian polymer, what you have is that the partition function is given by the integral over space of the solution at time one of stochastic heat equation with Dirac mass at zero for initial condition. And multiplicative white noise. So here we should have the same thing going on. But there is some care to have because, I don't know how to define psi times u here. So actually what you have to do is really when you have an atom appearing in your noise, you have to multiply at the value at the time immediately before. So maybe it's something quite common for people that do stochastic PDE, but we didn't have time to go through that. So I expect that you still have this connection, and maybe it goes further than that, but we haven't explored it fully.
If I can make a second question, so now that you put this slide, I can actually make the second question. That's very good. Of course, this is a very natural question, and I examined it some time ago. My idea at the time was that if you want to define a stochastic integration with respect to this Levy noise, you can do it, but it's not going to be an isomorphism between L2 and L2 because you're not in L2. But you can define a stochastic integration as some mapping between LP with P smaller than alpha and L alpha. So you lose a little bit on your stochastic integration. And because of this little bit that you lose, you cannot make a Picard iteration to actually solve this equation. So I was wondering if with your type of cutoff, you can actually try to do that. I mean, that you cut off first and then there's some, I don't know. Because you need just a little bit to make it work.
Yeah, actually I'm not sure. Well, okay. It shouldn't be difficult to make sense of this when you have your threshold on, but I'm not sure how to do that. So then taking the limit when A goes to zero is more complicated, of course. But in principle, it looks like, that's a promising direction. And,
okay. Well, thank you.
So yeah, if there are questions I hadn't seen, but you can do as Milton did and raise your hand and we can mute you and you can just speak. So Carsten, I will unmute you. Carsten?
Hi, everyone. So first of all, thanks for the really nice talk. So I just wanted to make a comment basically regarding the question that Milton has asked. So exactly for this question, for the stochastic heat equation with alpha stable noise, I actually have a paper on that. So if you're interested, I will send you a link in the chat. And it's exactly using the techniques I think that Milton describes. So basically using LP moment estimates instead of L2 estimates and then combined with some stopping time techniques.
Oh, this is great. Yeah, very nice. Thank you very much for this comment.
You're welcome.
Yeah, so it's many, many useful features of having plenty of people. Are there further questions or comments on the talk?
I have another question.
Yes.
Hubert, when you want to construct the continuum polymer measure associated to your model, I guess you need to put together partition functions start with different starting points. Which kind of regularity you have in the in the starting point of the continuum partition function you build?
No, you don't use this at all. What you only need to prove proving convergence of the partition function and convergence of the partition function with a continuous bounded function integrated is exactly the same because both of them are martingales. And if one is uniformly integrable, the other is uniformly integrable. So convergence of the partition function and convergence of finite dimensional marginals are the same. So you just need something for tightness. And it's not a very complicated argument. You get this directly without, you don't have to get it to do anything dirty in order to get the tightness.
I see. So you don't build the finite dimensional distribution of the continuum directly.
No.
Okay, thanks.
You just integrate the continuum against continuous bounded function in the Venus space.
Can I ask one more question also? So I'm curious how tractable your limit is. So can you compute something about this limiting partition function? So in the Brownian case, you know, obviously there is this whole integrable probability story. So can you?
You can say some stuff about it, but so for instance, if you look at one point in your Poisson process, you know that you're in the limit. You will go through it with positive probability. So every point of the in the Poisson process is visited with positive probability. So it makes the measure looks very singular with respect to Wiener measure. But on the other hand, if you fix a time t and you look at the distribution for a fixed time, what you get is absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue. And even if you take finite dimensional marginals for several times, okay? Well, this is absolutely continuous to Lebesgue with probability one. Okay, if you fix t, then it's because if not, you would have a contradiction with what I said before. But if you fix t, almost surely on this time, you have no atoms of your Poisson process. So this is pretty much what you can say. Some quantitative things, I don't know, we didn't think much about it, but I don't think you can make any exact computation. I don't know, it depends on what you want to know.
I see. Thanks.
Well, thank you very much. I think we will stop here. I think it was a great session. Life, can I give you the hand so that maybe we can all applaud at the same time? I'm worried I'm going to mess this up.
Let's give it a try. How did it work? Okay, so now everybody has...
Thank you very much.